All right, we carry on. Now, the immediate issue that Paul is addressing in 1 Corinthians chapter 11, verses 2 through 16, at least as I understand it, is whether it's permissible for women to remove the traditional head covering when praying in the assembly of believers. Now, though female prophesying was permitted only outside of the assembly, as we'll see when we get to chapter 14, Paul includes prophesying in his discussion because his ruling on whether praying uncovered in the assembly, whether that's permissible, that ruling will by logic also be a ruling on whether prophesying outside the assembly uncovered is permissible. So I think, Paul, the immediate issue is praying uncovered in the assembly, but Paul understands that what he says about that will also deal with the situation of prophesying uncovered. And so I think he puts them together, and I have some indication of that, that there's a split here in chapter 11, verse 13, that we'll get to today. In 11, the first section, in chapter 11, verse 2 to 6, so that's 2 to 16, that's the overall thing. In 2 to 6, Paul, he first praises the leaders for, and if you just came in, I went over this last week. I'm just kind of rushing through to get you back up to where we ended. So you're going, boy, he's going over this stuff really fast. Well, I talked about it last week. But in verse 2 to 6, he first praises the leaders for following the practice that he had passed on to them. And he then proceeds to give them reasons for the practice that they could use in defending their position against this current challenge or this current question of, is it permissible for the women who are praying in the assembly to cast off the head covering? He does that by, he first denies that sex distinctions are completely irrelevant in the church. And he does that by asserting that the relationship between men and women in Christ is not identical or reciprocal with regard to leadership. Rather, men are given the leadership responsibility in the church. And as I've said, that is not because women are incapable of leading, are stupid, are not as moral, or any of that. It is that God has chosen a select group for a function as he has throughout history. And so men have been given the leadership responsibility. And sometimes men don't like that, by the way. Sometimes they shirk that, and that's bad on them. Now, given the continuing relevance of sex for those who are in Christ, as he made clear at the beginning there, given that continuing relevance, it's inappropriate to reject cultural sex distinctions in attire, to engage in a kind of cross-dressing when publicly speaking to or on behalf of God. Just as it would be disgraceful for a man to pray or prophesy with a female covering on his head, so it's disgraceful for a woman to do so without it. And the disgrace of the woman speaking publicly without their traditional female covering, that disgrace would parallel the disgrace of the woman who had her hair cut short or shaved. You see, in that culture, both would involve appearing as a man, whether without the covering or having your hair cut short or shaved. In that culture, both of those would involve appearing as a man and therefore would be an act of rebellion against God's creation order. His having created mankind as two distinct sexes. Now, when we ended, we were just started looking at chapter 11, verses 7 through 12, and that's where I want to pick back up if I'm smart enough to work that. Okay, let's read it again. He says, "For a man ought not to cover his head, being the image and glory of God. The woman, on the other hand, is the glory of man. For man is not from woman, but woman from man. For neither was the man created on account of the woman, but the woman on account of the man. For this reason, the woman ought to have authority on her head on account of the angels. Nevertheless, neither is woman apart from man, nor man apart from woman in the Lord. For just as the woman is from the man, so also the man is by the woman. And all things are from God. Now verses 7 to 10, they provide an additional or a further reason why a man should not wear the cover about which he's speaking. It's the same cover that he's talking about. And you see he begins verse 7 with 4. So he's still talking about this distinctly female covering. And here he provides further reason why the man should not wear that particular covering when he's speaking, but a woman should. And it's this kind of sex inappropriate dressing. It contradicts or rebels against God's creation of mankind as two distinct sexes. And therefore is contrary to the fact that woman's existence glorifies man. That's kind of the twist. That's the interesting thing. It's contrary to this notion that woman's existence glorifies man, whereas man's existence glorifies only God. You remember last week I said woman's existence glorifies man, paren, in addition to God. But he says her existence glorifies man, man's existence glorifies only God. In other words, this difference in the object of glorification has implications for who is a suitable candidate for wearing the female covering. It has implications for that. And so that requires some unpacking because there are steps in here that Paul doesn't explain. I'm going to tell you what I think Paul is saying. And you do with that what you will. Woman's existence glorifies man. First, Paul tells us, well, why do you say that woman's existence glorifies man? And it glorifies man, Paul says, because the woman came from man. Man gave birth to the woman, and the woman was made to help the man, to be a non-leading partner. Now, he's obviously harking back to Genesis chapter 2, verse 20 to 23, where God made Eve from part of Adam's body. He did not make her independently from the ground. And he also did, God did so that Eve might be a helper for Adam. So woman's existence, Paul says, redounds to the glory of man. But man's existence does not likewise redound to the glory of woman because he wasn't created from her, nor was he created to be a helper for her. So that's the first thing, is this idea about woman's existence. She's the glory of man. Man is the glory of God. Now, given that woman is the glory of man, Paul says it is fitting that she be under a sign of authority. Literally, it says that she have authority on her head. Some people try to make hay out of that. It's pretty clear to me that he means she's to have the covering on, which functions as a sign or symbol of authority. And that's why you see in the large majority of translations reflect that. For instance, symbol, you have the English Standard, the Christian Standard, New English Translation, New Revised, New American. They say she's to have a symbol of authority. Other translations, she's to have a sign of authority. American Standard, New Jerusalem Bible, New English Bible, Revised English Bible. So I think it's clear, at least it is to me in those translators, that he's talking about, because she's the glory of man, given that she's the glory of man, it's fitting that she have a, be under a sign of authority when publicly speaking to or on behalf of God. That is, when she's praying or prophesying. Now, Paul doesn't explain why her being the glory of man means that she needs a sign of authority on her head. He simply leaves that out. He understands it. He thinks they understand it, but he doesn't explain it. I'm going to tell you what I think he's talking about. I think the reason, since she is the glory of man, I think the reason she needs a sign of authority on her head is that however glorious man may be, okay, she's the glory of man. However glorious man may be, man remains under the authority of God. She's the glory of man. She redounds to his glory, but however glorious man may be, he remains under the authority of God. And as the glory of man, woman needs to reflect that truth, the fact that man is still under the authority of God when speaking publicly to or on behalf of God. Since man, on the other hand, is the glory of God, a sign of authority over him would not be appropriate because there is no authority over God. Okay, so that I think so far that's where we are. Now, the head cover that Paul is speaking about, you say, what does that have to do with authority? It says she is to be have this sign of authority because she's the glory of man. You say, well, what does the head covering have to do? How does the head covering function as a sign of authority? What is the connection? How does it function that way? Well, the head covering that Paul's speaking about, in my judgment, it functions as a sign of authority precisely because it was a distinctly female piece of attire. You notice that Paul, he doesn't impose or prescribe that significance to it. He assumes or relies on that significance. Given that women were assigned a subordinate or a non-leading role by both culture and God, clothing that was distinctly female naturally symbolized being under the leadership or being under the authority of another. Now, Paul doesn't address how or why certain items of apparel come to be distinctly female. He simply assumes it. He just takes it for granted that that does in fact occur. And the end of verse 10, he gives yet another reason. He says, because woman is the glory of man, she needs this sign of authority on her head. Doesn't fill in all that I'm telling you, but I'm just telling you how I understand it. Okay? And then at the end of 10, he gives an additional reason why a woman should have a sign of authority on her head, meaning this female covering. He says she should do so on account of the angels. And that's really intriguing. On account of the angels, as I already mentioned, I think the best way to understand this is to recognize that angels observe the worship assembly and are concerned that the creation order be honored in that forum. I mentioned to you there are groups at the Essene group at Qumran have clear indications of this sense of angelic oversight or observation of the worship and the assembly of the people of God. You see, here's what Ciampa and Rossner say, Paul may well be referring to the angels as divinely appointed auditors of the community's worship who, like God, would be offended by any shameful displays during the worship. I think that's the sense that he has here. Larry Hurtado is a very well-known scholar. His specialty really is the early church worship practices. Hurtado writes in his book, At the Origins of Christian Worship, The Context and Character of Earliest Christian Devotion. Hurtado says, Christians experience their assemblies as not merely human events, but as having a transcendent dimension. And oh, that we would capture some of that. In our gathering together, in our understanding, in our sense, that we would elevate our gathering together with this sense of the transcendent. That there's something big. Oh, I got to go to church. I got to go to church. Man, you see, we're gathering as the redeemed of God. All right, he says, they sense God as directly and really present in their meetings through his Spirit. In 1 Corinthians 11:10, the curious passing reference to the angels present in the worship assembly shows how familiar the idea was. Do we think about that? You know, do we think that as we gather and we're singing and praising God and worshiping and God is speaking to us through his word? Do we think about that? Here we are with this host and we are part of that, I just love it. You know, so he goes on, he says, Paul's Corinthian readers apparently needed no further explanation, though we could wish for one. As the holy ones, saints of God, believers saw their worship gatherings as attended by heavenly holy ones, angels whose presence signified the heavenly significance of their humble house church assemblies. And I just think there's something there about the attitude and spirit. It's not drudgery. It's not, you know, small beans. It's really a glorious thing when we gather together to praise the one who made and redeemed us. And so Paul, he talks about that. I think that's the best way to understand that. And then in verses 11 and 12, Paul makes clear that the sex differences about which he's been speaking and which must continue to be honored in dress, he makes clear that they're not a matter of superiority, inferiority. They are different functions and different roles. Men and women in Christ, Paul says in verse 11, are mutually dependent. Men and women in Christ are mutually dependent. You see, they're each of them. Each needs the other, that mankind might be what God intended mankind to be. He made mankind as two distinct sexes. And we are mutually dependent in Christ that we might be what God intends us to be. So I think Paul wants to be sure that nobody takes this thing. You guys remember, well, some of you are too young for this, but you remember the Honeymooners with Ralph Cramden? I'm the king, Alice. You're nobody. I'm the king. You're nobody. I think he wants to caution against that, because he has gone and acknowledged the difference in function and a difference in sexes that needs to be honored. But he doesn't want that carried over into this idea that I'm the king and you're nobody, Alice. Mutually dependent. Mutually dependent. And then in verse 12, you see evidence of this mutual dependence is that whereas womankind was initially created from Adam, all subsequent men have come from women. And all things, men and women, come from the one God. So I think Paul wants them to see that there's this mutual dependence. Then he says in 13 to 16, judge among yourselves. I've told you before, I think this is more significant than he gets credit for, because I think Paul is here specifying the immediate and precise issue that gave rise to this discussion. Judge among yourselves. Is it proper that a woman pray to God uncovered? So people say to me, well, isn't it just arbitrary that you are simply separating praying and prophesying? I say, well, no, it's not. Because when we get to 14, you will see, I hope, clearly the meaning. And unless you do that, you wind up butchering 14. So not only do I see in 14 clearly to me that women are not to be prophesying in the assembly, but I also see this text, and I also see what Paul is saying. So I think this is important, where he says, is it proper that a woman pray to God uncovered? Does not nature itself teach you that if a man wears long hair, it is a dishonor to him, but if a woman wears long hair, it's a glory to her? For long hair has been given to her as a covering, but if anyone is disposed to be contentious, we have no such custom, nor do the churches of God. Now, Paul appeals to what they already recognized about long hair. Now, some people get, I think, get carted off by this. And they think, oh, the covering he's talking about is long. No, it's not. This is an analogy to the covering. This is an analogy, and Paul appeals to what they already recognized about long hair to make his point that women shouldn't pray uncovered. As I say, the fact that he mentions only praying in 13 indicates to me that was really the issue. Now, nature itself, this causes questions. Nature itself taught that long hair was a dishonor to men and a glory to women, in that the distinction of mankind into two sexes is a fundamental aspect of the creation order. People have a natural sense from creation of mankind into two distinct sexes. People have a natural sense from that gender bending, that confusing or masking sexual differentiation is wrong. And you think it is just by chance that that is under assault in our culture like crazy. That is a root issue of creation. That God made mankind as male and female. You open any paper, read anything on the internet, it's like, what are you, crazy? I'm gender fluid, baby. There's no such thing. All right, well, see, that's an assault on the creation order. That's an assault. But here he's talking about this idea, you see, nature itself, because of that fundamental distinctiveness of sexes in creation, what is contrary to that, what confuses or masks that differentiation is wrong. Now, given that sense of sexual distinction that's rooted in creation, the Corinthians would agree that if a man wore long hair, given that sense, right, of sexual differentiation that's rooted in creation, the Corinthians would agree that if a man wore long hair, it dishonored him, but if a woman wore long hair, it was to her glory, it exalted her. And they would agree with that because long hair had been culturally assigned as a kind of female covering. It was therefore inappropriate on a man. It was, in that cultural context, gender bending. Now, do you think Paul is not aware that male hair has the same capacity to grow long as female hair? Do you think Paul does not know that Nazarites were forbidden from cutting their hair? Okay, so he's well aware of this. So Paul is not suggesting that long hair is universally or transculturally contrary to sex distinctions. David Garland says in his commentary, long hair for men is unnatural for Paul because in his cultural context, it conveys sexual ambiguity and hints at moral perversion. Donald Fortson and Roland Grams in their book Unchanging Witness, they say Paul is saying there is a natural distinction between men and women. If a man crosses this barrier and dons the appearance of a woman by growing his hair long, he's degrading himself. Paul's point is not that long hair is impossible for a man to grow, but that an effeminate appearance for a man is unnatural because there are two sexes. So if he engages in this kind of masking of that distinction, that's why it's rooted in nature. You see, he says in 1 Corinthians 11, 2-16, Paul is saying that men should be men and women should be women according to nature. While hairstyles are a matter of custom, in Paul's day, long hair on men suggested effeminacy in Greek and Roman culture. For a man to have long hair then was like cross-dressing, purposefully appearing contrary to his nature. And this is what I think is going on. Paul's point is that the head covering, you see, the head covering that he's been talking about, his point is that it functions analogously to long hair. It's like long hair. It too was culturally assigned as a female covering, and it's therefore inappropriate on a man and inappropriate for a woman not to have it. So he's using what they understood about long hair in that cultural context as an analogy for the covering. That he's telling them, no, it's not right. They can't pray in the assembly and discard that covering, that distinctly female covering. Now, regardless of whether some want to argue the point, and I can see people saying, well, wait a minute, Paul, we're chipping away at the cultural norm. There are some wealthy women I heard over here in Rome or in this particular class or in this particular setting who are, you know, they're out there, baby. They don't have the covering. So maybe some persecution. So Paul just says, listen, he says, regardless of whether someone argue the point, he said, neither his group nor the other churches of God engage in the practice of women praying and prophesying uncovered. So the Spirit of God says through Paul, whatever you're saying to me about chipping away, if that's what they were saying, that's just me, okay? But whatever you're saying about that, the Spirit of God is saying through Paul, the cultural norm has not been displaced. It has not been displaced. And so therefore, for a woman to discard the covering, for a man to grow long hair, these things are contrary to the sexual distinctions that I created mankind with. That's what Paul is talking about. I'm convinced through this 2 through 16. So he's dealing with the assembly. He talks there about that. And then he moves on to another issue that they're having. And this is the Lord's Supper. And I think much to be learned here. He says in verse 17, you remember he was giving the instruction, he said, in this I praise you, because they were holding the fort, abiding by what he'd said, but then he gives them some information that would help them in dealing with the challenge that was being raised. Here he says, but in giving this instruction, I do not praise you, because you gather together not for the better, but for the worse. For in the first place, when you gather together as a church, I hear that divisions exist among you, and in part I believe it. For you say, brackets, that's my gloss that I will explain, okay? For you say, it is indeed necessary for factions to be among you, in order that also the approved ones may become apparent among you. Therefore, when you gather together in the same place, it is not to eat the Lord's Supper. For each one consumes his own supper when eating. And so one is hungry, but another is drunk. For it certainly cannot be that you do not have houses to eat and drink in, can it? Or do you have contempt for the church of God and so humiliate those who do not have? What shall I say to you? Shall I praise you? In this matter, I do not praise you. All right, so Paul here, Paul had praise, as I said, for the leaders and the lead-in for how they handle that matter of women praying and this issue coming up and the challenge about them, is it okay to pray uncovered? But he had no praise for the way the church assembled to eat the Lord's Supper. He'd heard that when they come together, there were divisions among them. And he's not referring here to horizontal divisions. See, horizontal divisions where understood equals divide over differences in practices or beliefs. He's not referring to that. He's referring to vertical divisions, where the body is stratified by the maintaining of social rankings. See, he's referring to socioeconomic segregation in the assembly. Now, Paul says he believes the report, he says, in part. See, to some extent, probably meaning that though he takes the report as credible, he assumes that not all the members of higher social rank were acting that way. When he says, I believe this in part. And that's a diplomatic way of giving some of them the benefit of the doubt. Now, verse 19, the one there I said I'll explain here, it's notoriously difficult. But I think Paul is saying he readily gives credence to what he heard about the segregation at their gatherings. He readily gives credence to what he heard for, you see, right there at verse 19, why does he readily give credence? He readily gives credence because he's aware that at least some in Corinth were claiming that such factions were necessary in order that the approved ones, the higher status people, they presumed were the tried and true of God. So that he's aware that at least some in Corinth are saying that such divisions have to exist so the approved ones might stand out and be obvious. See, so that's partly why Paul says, yeah, I readily lend credence to this because I hear this. Anthony Thistleton, whose commentary is the New International Greek Testament Commentary, Thistleton, he renders the verse this way. For, quote, dissensions are unavoidable, indicating that he sees that as something from the Corinthians. It is claimed among you. Now, that's not in the text. Okay? but it's trying to understand the text in the flow of what Paul is saying. So he says, it is claimed among you in order that those who are tried and true among you may be visibly revealed. Now, there are other very well-known commentators, David Garland, Roy Ciampa, and Brian Rossner. They agree that Paul is referring here to a Corinthian sentiment, but they think Paul's doing so with bitter irony or sarcasm, mentioning the claim, you see, with a rebuking tone, rather than merely mentioning the sentiment as an explanation for why he so readily gives credence to the report about the factions. I think the latter makes better sense, that Paul cites it because that's why he so readily gives credence to the report that he's heard. But the important point is that both of those views see the sentiment as the Corinthians rather than Paul's. So they're united on that. And I think that's the key. Ciampa and Rossner say, Paul most likely is referring to a view that was reported to him as being held by some Corinthians. They thought the differences among them were a reflection of those who had God's special approval. You see, well, you know, I'm here, I'm standing out, I need to stand out because I have God's special blessing and approval. So if I blend in and all that kind of stuff, then you won't see who's really God's man. You see, so he says here, they thought the differences among them were a reflection of those who had God's special approval. The following verses make it clear, however, that the divisions were provoked by the insensitive behavior of some of the social elites within the Corinthian church, and that that behavior most certainly did not meet with God's approval. If anyone could be said to have God's approval in the Corinthian church, it would not be any of those wealthier and more socially advanced Christians who were snubbing their brothers and sisters. Now, if you say, well, no, I don't like this idea of reading into that, that this was really something that they... Well, if you reject that and you take this as a declaration of Paul's view, okay, which is possible. I just think it's unlikely. If you take that view... Well, then Paul is saying that factions were necessary in Corinth in order that genuine believers there in Corinth might be distinguished from the imitators. You see, in that case, Paul's view is that differences need to exist between genuine and imitation believers in mixed congregations like Corinth. So that's something, see, they should be factious in that sense. So that seems to be the option if you say, no, this is Paul's view. Now, the fact they maintained social divisions in their gatherings, that meant that they had missed an essential aspect of the Lord's Supper. The Lord's Supper simply cannot be. It is spiritually impossible for the Lord's Supper to be eaten in a segregated, class-conscious assembly. It simply cannot be eaten in that context. The Lord's Supper can't be eaten that way. That denies the very oneness that the supper symbolizes. You see in 1 Corinthians chapter 10, verse 17, our fellowship in Christ transcends social divisions. I don't care what they are. In the ancient world, you saw that. Huge social divisions, class divisions. And the unity that is in Christ transcends those social divisions. And we have to recognize that. You see, maintaining those social divisions when eating the Lord's Supper contradicts the truth that Christ transcends social division. Now, the social nature of the divisions is evident in verses 21 and 22. You can see here the Corinthians, along with other first century Christians, they often celebrated the Lord's Supper in conjunction with a larger fellowship meal. This is the love feast, or the agape, that you read about in Jude verse 12. And that's alluded to in 2 Peter chapter 2 verse 13. Now the supper proper, meaning the bread and the fruit of the vine, probably was eaten at the end of that meal. And this fellowship meal, this love feast, this agape, this was an optional practice of benevolence and fellowship that early on was separated from the Lord's Supper. which is a remembrance of a remembrance and proclamation of the death and resurrection of Jesus. And the love feast eventually was dropped, at least as a regular practice. But here you see it, in effect, the supper is being eaten in conjunction with this love feast. And when the Corinthians gathered, the wealthier Christians, the better off, the higher social standing, who no doubt supplied most of the food for the fellowship meal, they were somehow taking a disproportionate share of it. Whether they were gathering in their own separate room to eat, or whether they simply just weren't sharing it, but they were taking a disproportionate share of the food. They were eating, he says in verse 21, their own supper. You see, they're eating their own supper. And the haves, they had more than enough. They had more than enough, as indicated by the fact that you see some of them here, they wind up being intoxicated. You see, the haves, they have more than enough, because they wind up consuming an excess of wine. So that's telling you, it's not a matter of, well, we hardly have enough. They got enough. So they got plenty, and the have-nots were what? They were left hungry. They were treated as stepbrothers, treated as second-class citizens in the body of Christ, and they were humiliated in the process. And Paul, in doing that, Paul suggests that the wealthy, they were doing what? They were showing contempt for the church of God. And he repeats that he has no praise for them in this matter. And then he says in 23 to 26, "For I received from the Lord what I also delivered to you, that the Lord Jesus, on the night in which he was betrayed, took bread, and after giving thanks, broke it and said, 'This is my body that is for you. Do this in remembrance of me.' In the same way, after supper, he took the cup also, saying, 'The cup is the new covenant in my blood. Do this as often as you drink it in remembrance of me. For as often as you eat this bread and drink the cup, you proclaim the Lord's death until he comes.'" See, Paul cannot praise them. He cannot praise them for keeping the tradition of the supper, because they did so in a way that was inconsistent with the supper's original intent. And he points that out by reminding them of what he'd previously taught them about the supper. What you're doing is inconsistent with the supper's original intent. Here's what I said to you about the supper. As instituted by Christ himself, the supper is a memorial of the salvation which he has effected through his death and resurrection. By the wealthy discriminating against the poor in the fellowship meal, they were negating the very point of Christ's death. They were negating the point of Christ's death to create a new people for his name, to create a new community, a new people, a redeemed community in which the old distinctions of human fallenness no longer held sway. And here you are at a gathering sharing in the Lord's Supper, and you're segregating, and you're dishonoring your brothers, you're treating them as second class, because you got your nose in the air and you think that Christ doesn't transcend that division. That's what Paul's after. Then he says in 27, "So then, whoever eats the bread or drinks the cup in an unworthy manner shall be guilty of the body and blood of the Lord. But let a man test himself, and in that way eat of the bread and drink of the cup. For the one who eats and drinks without discerning the body eats and drinks judgment on himself. For this reason, many among you are weak and sick, and enough are sleeping. But if we were discerning ourselves, we would not be coming under judgment. But in being judged by the Lord, we're being disciplined, that we may not be condemned with the world." I'm racing here because I heard that bell, and I always get caught. And so I'm trying to at least get through a unit. All right, so now, given the significance of the Lord's Supper, whoever participates in the supper in an unworthy manner, meaning those here in this context, however you want to extend that, you know, that's you have to sit and say, okay, well, what does this apply? But in this context, taking it in an unworthy manner means those who eat it while maintaining socioeconomic divisions. And Paul says, those who eat it in an unworthy manner shall be guilty of the body and blood of the Lord. And that probably means that by thus missing the point of the supper, which is to honor and proclaim Christ's sacrificial work, by which one new man, Paul's phrasing in Ephesians 2:15, by which one new man is created from people of all different groups, transcending all divisions, one in Christ. Well, by doing that, they place themselves under the same liability as those who are responsible for Christ's death. David Garland says, Paul's logic is this: the Lord's Supper proclaims the Lord's death. Those whose behavior at the Lord's Supper does not conform to what that death entails effectively shift sides. They leave the Lord's side and align themselves with the rulers of this present age who crucified the Lord. This explains how they make themselves so vulnerable to God's judgment. And to avoid that guilt, each person needs to examine himself in terms of his attitude toward the members of the body before participating in the supper. You see, if he fails to do that, if he eats without recognizing the reality and the oneness of the body of Christ, as some of them were doing, well, that person will incur God's judgment. Champ and Rossner say, to examine oneself and to discern the body of Christ do not merely mean in this context to solemnly recognize that the bread and cup represent Christ's body and blood rather than being mundane food and drink. To examine oneself means to examine one's compliance with the covenant as reflected in their ways of relating to other members of the community, and to discern the body of Christ must include recognizing that those other members of the community represent Christ himself, since they've been united with him, and must be treated as people for whom Christ chose to give up his life and to shed his blood. Do you think they were doing that in Corinth while they iced out the lower classes, treated them as second class? Do you think they were treating them as people for whom Christ died? No. See, that's what's going on. Now, my brother John tells of his experience as a young Christian at a small church in Georgia nearly 40 years ago. He worked there one summer, and he was fired for blistering that church for its racism. Let me just finish this story. I heard that bell. He was fired for blistering, and I mean blistering, that church for its racism. Now, it pains me to say that one member of that congregation confided in John before he left that he had succeeded in persuading her that, yes, it was really wrong not to allow black men and women to be members of the congregation. But then she added, but I don't want them sitting up front with us. Now, do you think that the supper that those people were eating every Lord's Day, do you think that was in any way, shape, or form the Lord's Supper? Nonsense. See, and I'm telling you, lack of teaching has killed us. See, somebody needed to say this to those people. Now, John said some stuff. He didn't say this. But so, yeah, you can talk to him about it there. Yeah. All right. I heard the bell. Thanks for coming.